Okay, so now we are looking at instruction known as SIM. SIM stands for Set Interrupt Mask. Set Interrupt Mask. So what we are trying to do is, okay, in the circuit diagram that we have just seen, we saw that there were three blocks named M7.5, M6.5, M5.5, and I told you that these blocks are to mask one particular interrupt. Okay, whenever we are using IE flip-flop, it is going to disable all the interrupts at once. But suppose you have, you want to mask one particular interrupt, then we can use this. Okay, if any of these is one, then that particular interrupt. That particular interrupt is masked. That particular interrupt is masked. The default register for doing this is a accumulator. Default register is the accumulator. The 8 bits of the accumulator are represented like this. Okay, these are, see, this is serial output data. This is serial data enable. Okay, we're going to see what is the function of these things, but for now you can just understand, whenever the microprocessor wants to communicate serially with the device, wants to transfer data serially, we are going to use these pins. For now we are looking at the masking. You must remember in 7.5, RST 7.5, in that D flip-flop we had an option. So this is to reset 7.5 flip-flop. Okay, we had an option reset 7.5 there. This is to do that. This one is to do that. This is mask set enable. Mask set enable. So whenever you want to mask any of these interrupts, whenever you want to mask 7.5, 6.5, 5.5, you have to make this one. MSC should be one. Okay, mask set enable should be one. Now these are mask 7.5, mask 6.5, mask 5.5. So we are going to have a look at an example. Suppose you are asked. Suppose you are given that you need to mask RST 6.5 and unmask or do not bother RST 7.5 and RST 5.5. So we are just going to look at the status of this accumulator first. First you quickly write the bit SOD SDE. Don't care. This is don't care, okay? This bit can be 0 or 1. Nobody cares, okay? So, generally we consider it as 0 only. We're going to take it as 0. RST 7.5, MSC, M7.5, M6.5, M5.5. Now, just see. We're not interested in serial output data. So, this is going to be 0. Serial data enable 0. Don't care 0. We do not want to reset 7.5 flip-flop, so 0. We want to mask any of these, so this is going to be 1. We do not want to mask 7.5, 0, 1, 0. Now see, what is this number? What is this number in a hexadecimal? Let us see. This is going to be 10 or A. So what instruction am I going to write? See, I already told you, default register for this is A. So what am I going to do? I'm going to write MVI A, AH. 0AH. What is this going to do? This is going to load the accumulator, going to load the A register with this data. After writing this, I write this instruction SIM, set interrupt mask. So what does this do? This instruction, this loads the accumulator with 0A, with this data, and after I write this instruction SIM, this is going to mask RST 6.5. Okay, let us just take one more example. Suppose you've got an example. write an ALP to mask RST 6.5, RST 7.5 and RST 5.5. Okay, now you have got to mask all the interrupts, all RST 6.5, 7.5 and 5.5. We have to mask all three of them. Again, I am going to make this status of this accumulator quickly. SOD, SDE, don't care. RST 7.5, MSC, M7.5, M6.5, M5.5. So this is going to be 0, 0, 0, 0. MSC is going to be 1 since I need to mask some interrupts. I have to mask all of them. So these all are going to be 1. Now what is this number in hexadecimal? Let us just see. These 4 bits represent 0. These 4 bits represent F. So what am I going to do is, I am going to move MBIA 0FH and after that SIM. So what does this instruction do? This instruction loads the accumulator with this data, and this SIM, what does this do? This masks all these interrupts, mask all these interrupts. Okay, look at one more example. You can try this by your own maybe, and after you try, you can just check the answer. Just try this question on your own. Write an ALP. Okay, ALP is assembly language program is what you write to function a microprocessor. Write an ALP to reset 7.5 flip-flop. Okay, you can just try this by yourself first. After that maybe you can check the answer. I'm giving the solution here though. See, serial output, serial data, all this is going to be 0. We need to reset 7.5 flip-flop. This is going to be 1. I do not need to mask any of the interrupts. So, I am going to take this 0, 0, 0, 0. So, these represent 0. This represents 1. So, what am I going to do is MVIA 10H and after that SIM. This is going to be the simple instruction that you need to do to reset the 7.5 flip-flop. Why am I resetting 7.5 flip-flop? Probably, most probably we do this when we have already serviced 7.5 flip-flop either, so that there is no confusion. Okay, so we just reset 7.5 flip-flop. Okay, so this is a simple instruction to set interrupt mask, to make masking of interrupts. Now there is one more instruction which is to read interrupt mask, okay, which is to know the status of pending interrupts. Or whatever is the status of IE flip-flop, you can know by that instruction. Let us just take a look at that also. Okay, so there is an instruction. There is another instruction known as RIM. RIM. What does RIM do? It reads interrupt masks. Previously, we've learned the instruction SIM, which set interrupt mask. This reads interrupt mask. So, what is this? Okay. Default register here also is going to be accumulator. It's going to read the status from the accumulator only. So, what happens is, whenever you're going to give this instruction, RIM, okay, the value of accumulator will be displayed. They'll tell you the value of the accumulator, what is stored in the accumulator. Accordingly, you can just interpret, okay. So this is SID. If SID is 1, that means this is to input serial input data. This tells the status of interrupt. These three pins are going to tell status of interrupts. That is, if their value is 1, that means these interrupts are pending. Okay, suppose it is 100, that means 7.5 is pending, these have been solved or they did not come, whatever. This tells you the status of IE flip-flop. Okay, so you can know whether IE flip-flop is set or reset. This tells you either these interrupts, RST 7.5, 6.5, 5.5, either they are masked or not. So you can know either they are masked or not. Okay, if one, that means they are masked. They are masked. If zero, that means they are not masked. So using this instruction RIM read interrupt mask, we can just read the value of the accumulator and know the status of the interrupts or whether they are masked or not. So this is all related to interrupts, hardware interrupts. Next we are going to look at software interrupts. Okay, so now we look at software interrupts. So we've already seen about 5 hardware interrupts. We've seen their programming, how to set the masking, how to read masking, how to enable flip-flop. We've also seen the diagram, the circuit diagram of all the hardware interrupts. Now we look at software interrupt. So already we have discussed that there are 2 types of interrupt. One is vectored interrupt, which have fixed address, which have fixed location, that whenever you have you raise those interrupts, they'll reach a fixed address, fixed ISR is going to be executed. Also we learned that there's one non-vectored interrupt, which was INTR. INTR is a non-vectored interrupt, which means that there is no fixed location where its ISR is being stored. So what happens is, generally this pin INT A bar, which is interrupt acknowledgement, this is going to be high, this is going to be 1 all the time, okay? But as soon as you're giving this INTR, as soon as you raise this interrupt INTR, you make this 1, okay, what happens is this pin INT A bar, it becomes 0, okay, this becomes 0. These are known as, these gates that I've put here, they are known as tri-state buffers. Tri-state buffers can have 3 states. They can be off, they can be off, and they can be high impedance. So generally they are high impedance state. Okay, they will be high impedance, nothing will be input in this gate. But as soon as this INT A bar becomes 0, and see there is a bubble here, the bubble means it becomes 1 after entering this. So all these gates, they become on, they get the supply and they are on. Whatever is the input to these gates, whatever is the input to these gates, that becomes the opcode, that becomes the opcode for the microprocessor. Suppose the input was 1110011. So this becomes the opcode here. Okay, opcode. Now see this is E0111, this is 7. So E7 is the opcode that the microprocessor got. Actually this INT A bar, this pin is actually used to obtain the opcode. Since INTR is a non-vectored interrupt, it does not have a fixed address. Whenever this is raised, this microprocessor is going to send out the signal INT A bar to obtain the opcode. Now what happens, there are 8 software interrupts which are RST0 to RST7. These are their corresponding opcodes. There is no fixed address where this INTR is going to branch. Any of these opcodes, any of these address may come here and the input is treated as opcode. Since now we have got E7 internally in the microprocessor, what is going to take place? Opcode that we have got is E7. So that means RST4 has come, RST4. So what happens internally? Call 0020 is going to take place. Call 0020, since the address for this interrupt is 0020, call 0020 is going to take place. This is how software interrupts are going to work. Okay, and one more thing, the size of these instruction is 1 byte. Right, 1 byte. So therefore software interrupts are also called 1 byte call instruction. Generally you know, right, call instruction is going to take up 3 bytes of memory, but here see, to call one address you had to give one opcode E7 and it takes up only 1 byte. Okay, one more thing that you can note here is this INTR has to be minimum pulse of 5.8 microseconds. Why so? See, the microprocessor is going to check INTR before every last pulse of the current instruction. Suppose it is executing an instruction of 4T state. An instruction of 4T state is being executed. So in the third T state, in the third clock pulse, the microprocessor is going to check if INTR is there or not. Okay. So the and the longest instruction, longest possible instruction in this 8085 is call. Call. Call is having 18 T states. 18 T states. Right, call is having 18 T states, is the longest instruction. So before, if by any chance call has come, so before finishing of call instruction, before the 18th T state, the microprocessor is going to check for INTR. So minimum length of INTR should be, see, we suppose that in 17.5th cycle it is going to check. Also, you know the frequency of microprocessor is 3 megahertz. So 17.5 into 1 by 3, which is approximately 5.8 microseconds, 5.8 microseconds. Therefore, whenever INTR is given, it should be of minimum duration of 5.8 microseconds, so that whenever microprocessor checks for INTR, it should be present. And this is how it is going to obtain its opcode. Okay, these are the addresses and opcodes of the 8 software interrupts. RST0 is having opcode C7. See, there is a pattern, you do not need to learn them. RST0 is C7, then CF, D7, DF, E7, EF, F7, FF. And also in their address 008, 1018, 2028, 3038. I don't think you need any formula to learn them. Maybe, okay, if anybody. So these are the 8 software interrupts, these are their corresponding opcodes, and these are their fixed addresses. Whenever you are going to give INTR, the microprocessor gives INTA bar, which is to obtain the opcode. Opcode is obtained with the help of these tri-state buffers, which are generally high impedance whenever INTA bar is 1. But whenever INTA bar becomes 0, they become on, and whatever is the input to these gates, they are going to give this to microprocessor. This is interpreted as the opcode of the given interrupt, and according to the opcode, you are going to decode it and know which instruction is to be given and what is the fixed address. Then 1 byte call instruction will be executed, and minimum time for which you should give INTR is 5.8 microseconds. Okay.